helps if I turn the microphone on. You can hear me without it, but the recording can't hear me without it. I guess I'm not loud enough yet, so I'll work on that. But good morning, GS fam. It's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. The weather is starting to warm up, and people are starting to go out and about. If you're new or this is your first service, please get with our ushers, and they will give you a welcome card. Just fill it out so we can better learn how to serve you in your life while you are here at Inserlik. Welcome to our service. We hope you feel like family when you come to our service. And if you would join me in prayer, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us to this service today. Thank you for bringing us to your house so we may worship you and learn about your gospel. Bless the people that are not here today, Lord, that are out and about, or maybe they're just at home and they needed to take a break today. Just be with them and lay your hands on them. Be with their hearts and be with our families back home. Be with the worship team as they lead us in worship today, and be with Chaplain Black as he delivers your gospel to us today. In your name I pray, amen.
Good morning, JS fan. So if you can stand with me, I'm going to be doing the response reading. So our response reading is taken from text Psalm 86, and it's 8 to 11. There's none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and worship before you, Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in the truth. Unite my heart to fear your name.
You are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you, who are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, who you are. You are good. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation and generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you, who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah. My hands to the heavens, I lift my eyes to where my help comes from. Look to you, my rock, my healer, trust in you. Freedom is here, freedom is here. Freedom is here, and I receive it. Freedom is here, freedom is here, freedom is here, and I receive. Sickness can't stay any longer. Your perfect love is casting out fear. You are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life be healed. Sickness can't stay any longer. Your perfect love is casting out fear. You are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life be healed. Sickness can't stay any longer. Your perfect love is casting out fear. You are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life be healed. Freedom is here. Freedom is here. Freedom is here. And I receive it. Freedom is here. Healing is here. Freedom is here. and I receive
it. Again, it's announcement time. So after the service, there will be a fellowship meal, so please stay behind to have some food, and then you can read on the pamphlet to see what we have available. We have some Bible study during the week, and then volunteer training is today. Please, if you want to volunteer, please try to stay behind and see our gospel fellowship members. For any other things, Desiree, please look at your bulletin. Is Tithes and Offerings?
I want to throw one more announcement in. In about 2 or so weeks, we have a trip planned to Antioch. So if you'd like to get on that trip, just keep a close eye on your emails. We'll be sending something out here shortly in the next week or so to let you know. So if that's of interest to you, Antioch would be a fun place to go. The Bible says in the book of Acts, that's the first city in which the believers were called Christians. They were called Christians at Antioch. So it's a nice historical biblical site to go to. So I keep your antenna up for that, okay? Thank you.
Amen. Morning, GS family. It is tithe and offering time. For those of you like me, if you don't carry cash, there's a QR code inside your bulletin. Please bow your heads in prayer with me. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you for this blessing. Thank you for today. Please allow those who are able to give to do so with a cheerful heart, and those who cannot, please bless their time of volunteerism in your name. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you. Well, take your Bibles with me, please, and turn to 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy. Taking a break from our look into the lives of Saul and David and Samuel, and want to look at a very special passage here that should be very meaningful to all of us. 1 Timothy chapter 2. So as you turn your Bibles there, I just recall how there was this poor fellow who got himself into trouble with the law. And so he had been served his papers, and he had a court appearance. He was going to be arraigned, and he needed to get himself a lawyer. But not having much money, he got the best lawyer he could for the money. Turned out the lawyer wasn't that good. The lawyer, among other things, didn't tell this man, the client who hired him, some important things about his own status as a lawyer and his own skills as an attorney. Turns out that unbeknownst to them and the court at the moment, he was actually unqualified. What had happened is he didn't pass his renewal exam for the bar to keep his law license current. But nobody knew that at the time. And actually his skills were suffering too, because this lawyer didn't really know his client's case very well. And that's because he wouldn't do the work to relate to his client. And he lacked, really, to be honest with you, he lacked the passion and the understanding that he should have with his client to know him well. Truth is, if he had put himself, you know, like we should do sometimes, if he had just put himself in his client's place, you know, and kind of entered his client's world of the trouble he was in, if he had just put himself in his client's place, then he, of course, would be able to sympathize with his client. And, you know, and with that sympathy, he would have done a better job of mediating. He would have been more effective as an attorney, as one who would mediate for his client in court. And here we have in our passage, if you'll look with me there, in 1 Timothy chapter 2, we have another example of an attorney or lawyer. And we find that reading from verses 1 through 5. As Paul writes to Timothy, Timothy being a young pastor, Paul being kind of a spiritual father and mentor to him, he's helping Timothy to know what it means to be a God-fearing, Bible-following pastor. And he says to Timothy there, "First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people." Now, when it says all people there, of course, we understand it doesn't mean literally every person in the world, because that would be impossible for anyone to do, right? So what we really mean here is all kinds of people, and probably particularly all the people that you're aware of that's in your life, okay? All kinds of, for all people. And then he starts to list the kinds of people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. And there is that word. We're going to take our camera and we're going to zoom in on that one phrase. There is one mediator. And that's, of course, what a lawyer is. He mediates between the judge and the law that's in front of the judge in his books, and the client, the citizen who's standing there, and between that citizen and that judge and his representation of the law comes a lawyer. And the lawyer represents his client to the judge. He mediates. And so here we see there is one God and there is one mediator between God, who is also known as a judge, and men and people. That would be us. Comma, who is it? The man Christ Jesus. And so, one who intercedes between conflicting parties. And so for a lawyer, his job is to come between two conflicting parties, and his goal is to bring some sort of a reconciliation, some way to work it out. For the lawyer, of course, to the best of his client. For the judge, and sometimes a jury, to the best of the law. And so there is a conflict that needs to be worked out. But this is in reference to us. And this is not about something you might do or have done or may do in your future here on earth that might put you in court and it might cause you to have to hire a lawyer. This is of a significance that's far beyond that. This is the significance of eternity. This is about not a local court, not a state court, not a federal court, not any global court. This is the eternal court. This is the sovereign court of eternity. This is the ultimate court. This makes the Supreme Court look like a piece of dust. This is God's tribunal. This is the court for which everyone that has ever lived will answer and stand before God. And this court is of the highest importance to us because the verdict given by this judge, God, doesn't result in a commuted sentence, doesn't result in community service, doesn't result in a night in jail or a week or a month or even 10 years. In fact, it's far beyond a life sentence. Because of the life sentence, sometimes you can get parole before you get to the end. But a life sentence is just man and the system putting you in prison until you die physically. But this court is not just physical. This court is spiritual. This is the court of the soul. This is an account that considers you as a whole person. If this poor man and his not-so-good lawyer are not successful and the man ends up going to jail, the sentencing and the prison really have nothing to do with this man's motives, like what's going on inside of his heart, what his thoughts are. It's not about any crimes he did prior to the one for which he stands in court. And it's not about any crimes that he may commit after he finishes, let's say, a year in jail for whatever he did. Future crimes. But here in our verse, there is one God and there is one mediator between God and us. That is a consideration of everything you've ever done, said, thought, and felt. And so it is very important. In fact, it is the most important thing we can talk about. So, of course, if this be the case, and it is, I would want the best mediator I could ever get so that I would have a chance of something. Because I already know this. I'm a guilty man. And I'm looking at a room full of guilty people. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So we already know we're guilty. And we won't be guilty for one crime. We are guilty of a lifetime's worth of crimes. So that means we already know what the sentence is. Guilty. So it's not a matter of the courts hopefully being persuaded or some jury being persuaded that we're innocent, in which case we get off the hook and we walk out free. This is not the case. When we read about this lawyer, this mediator, it's already a fact that we're guilty. all the more reason why we need to know who this mediator is. And so we see here. The first thing we know from Scripture is that mankind needs a mediator because he is a lawbreaker. The Bible says that sin, in 1 John, it says sin is lawlessness. It is the breaking of the law. Someone in my family, I was on the phone talking to folks back in the U.S., and someone in my family was recently discovered to have stolen something, taken something that didn't belong to him. And so we were on the phone, and I had the opportunity to say to him, well, you know, that is one of the Ten Commandments, right? Thou shalt not steal. And you've broken one of God's laws. And so what do you need to do? And I was prompting this person because I wasn't sure if they really understood that it wasn't just a horizontal crime, one person against another, me taking your things and stealing them. It was an eternal, moral, spiritual crime against God vertically. And I just didn't want to have it this idea that, well, you return it and you give your apologies and maybe it'll all be taken care of. Oh, no, no, no. That's so incomplete. That's why this verse helps us. Because this verse doesn't say there is one God and one mediator between one man and another, between one person and another. It says there's a mediator between God and us. And so I wanted to say to this person in my family, you have got to do business with God about the fact that you stole something from someone else. It's not just horizontal, person to person, side to side. And that's because we are lawbreakers, and he broke the law of God, the Ten Commandments. He broke that command. He sinned. But the Bible doesn't just say that, you know, for all of us have sinned, right? It goes further than that. I mean, we have verses like Romans, right, 3:23, but Romans 1:18 tells us that the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven. We need a mediator because we're lawbreakers. And it's not just that we're lawbreakers, it's that the result of that is the wrath of God comes on us. No different than the wrath of the court comes down hard on someone who's convicted, say, of murder or of child molestation or rape or something of this sort or some sort of violent crime. The wrath of the court comes down. The judge and or jury slam that wooden hammer down, that gavel. Bam! Here's your sentence. Here's what's going to happen to you for the next X number of years. Here's the penalties you face. And so the wrath of the court comes down. But here, it's a wrath we can't handle. There are men and women who go to prison for 5, 10, 15, 30 years, whatever, and they get out. They're that many years older, but they get out. And of course, in some cases, they have earned a couple of college degrees, started a business, become better people. Perhaps they came to Christ and became a Christian. That would be something to praise God for. They can come out better than when they went in. And that's great. There are those that don't, but still, the point is that a sentence has its limits and a person gets out and they're back out in society free again. It doesn't work like this with this verse. There is no getting out if you're guilty. It's why the Bible says in so many places, you look in the Gospels especially, in some parts of Acts and the Epistles, you find that the wrath of God, if the wrath of God rightly falls on you at Judgment Day, your sentence is eternal, from which there is no turning, getting out. There is no escape. There is no end to it. And so, my, how we need to say to ourselves, I have to get out from underneath the wrath of God that I deserve to be under. No different than a murderer who really has murdered, and he knows it, and his lawyer knows it. But the lawyer is sitting there saying, how can I somehow minimize or get this guy or gal off or with a lesser sentence? And he does that work to try, right? But for us, there is no such thing. our mediator won't be there to say, well, just give him a reduced sentence. Or put him on community service. No. This is an eternal life sentence with no end. And so mankind needs a mediator because he's a lawbreaker. People are rebels against God. You take a look at a passage like Ephesians chapter 2, where it's a beautiful chapter because it describes the two sides of the mediation that Christ does. And so when you look at Ephesians 2, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins, meaning spiritually dead, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, that's the devil, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. There are several places in God's word that give a quick description of what life is like for all people until they experience a saving change that Jesus gives. We're all rebels. We're all going our own way, right? No man seeks after God. We've all turned aside. And sometimes people might say, well, that's kind of harsh, you know, that God would do this. Well, again, even in our own system of justice, we have measures of how much consequence to give, right? You know, I can be pulled over for my speeding, and I can receive my ticket with respect. I can backtalk the police and resist him, and then I'm going to get into another level of trouble. I can take off my car and run from him and create a police chase in which I probably eventually will crash or be caught. I can go into courts and I can insult the judge. I can just elevate, right? Any of us can just elevate. We can do worse and worse, and so it'll go up, right? What'll happen? I can steal a soda out of the 7-Eleven, and there'll be a certain amount of a charge and a certain amount of consequence. I can steal a car, and the amount goes up. I can steal a person, and the amount goes up. So punishments and crimes, we try to make them fit. But what would be the punishment against an infinite God, against the very creator of the universe, against the God who's given you everything, including your next breath? You see, so when we calibrate that, no wonder it's of an eternal consequence, because it's an eternal God that we are sinning against. Well, what does this do, these crimes? As I said, we need a mediator because we're lawbreakers. But secondly, mankind needs a mediator because his sin separates him from God. So we have a very classic passage like Isaiah 59:2, right? Isaiah 59:2 is worth contemplating. It's worth time to look at. And I encourage you to look at it sometime this week when you do your devotions. Just spend a few minutes thinking through each word where Isaiah says, but your iniquities are sins. Your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. It's not that God can't hear. It's not that God can't see. That's imagery. That's word pictures to describe the fact that our sin makes God turn away. He's not going to look and he's not going to listen. Unless he sees and hears a repentant heart turning to him. When he sees that, he says, ah, now let me listen and see with this person. I see their heart. I see sincerity. I now see they really see their need for me. They see their sin. Now we're on a track toward conversion. They're turning to me with all their heart. Now I will listen. But in the normal state of things, we as lawbreakers, we are separated from God, and God has turned from us. Just like when Jesus on the cross realized that there was that time of separation between him and the Father, right? And it was that horrific moment, never before experienced, and never afterwards, in which God, who is triune, had a fracture or a break, in which the Father and Son had a time in which the Father turned and the Son felt it and cried out, because the sins of all who believe were now on Jesus. The filth of my sin and yours was now on him. And the Father could not accept to look at that, just as it says here. Your sins have hidden God's face from you. He does not hear. And so that separation, that gets us in trouble. That's another reason we need a mediator. And isn't this what happens when this poor fellow breaks the law, and now he's in this position now. It hasn't been settled yet, but he's really, in a sense, in a position where he may very well be separated from the rest of society. He's going to go to court. He's going to have his charges. Then there's going to be a verdict. And if that verdict is indeed one of guilt, then he gets, in the case of prison, he gets separated from society for a time. This is what our sin does to us and God. It separates us from him because he is pure and holy and absolutely perfect, and we're the opposite of all of that. A third reason that we need this mediator, this kind of lawyer, this go-between, is because of the verdict we are under. When I say are, I'm referring to people in their natural, sinful state. Christians are no longer under this. But I can't decide whether you're a Christian or not in your own heart. Only the Lord and you have the best. The God has a perfect knowledge of your heart, and you have a pretty good knowledge of your own heart. But it's very difficult sometimes for us, right, to evaluate each other. But nevertheless, it's true. So, for example, we know John 3:16 very well, but how about John 3:36, the last verse of the chapter? Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. It doesn't say that the wrath of God is now put on them as if it were for the first time. Notice, too, it says obeys. Jesus is to be obeyed. Jesus is not an option. Jesus is not just a mere free choice as if you were shopping for something. The gospel is a command. The gospel is not a mere invitation. As if we could say, I'll turn down that invitation. I'm kind of busy right now. Or it doesn't fit my schedule, so I'll turn that invitation down. Would you please consider Jesus? Well, maybe. That's really not the way the gospel is presented in Scripture. And that's not the intention of the gospel that God gives. The good news is a rescue command to us to turn to him. Because the Bible says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess one day, whether it be here or in eternity, it's going to happen one way or the other. And we're not in a position with God in which we can say, maybe, I'll consider it. He looks down and says, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? And so this is why this verse says the wrath of God remains. What does it mean to remain? It means it was already there. It was already there, right? If you go back to 3:18, John 3:18, right? If you look at that, it backs this verse up perfectly. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already. That's why I said at the beginning, we are already guilty. We are already criminals. We are already lawbreakers. We're not coming to Jesus as mediator because we might get off of something because we're truly innocent. It's the opposite. We are already guilty. When we walk into God's courtroom, we walk in guilty. But if you walk in with the wrong mediator, the wrong lawyer, then your guilt will remain. And the sentence will be dropped on you. And it's an eternal sentence. And there is no parole. And there is no having your case revisited 5 years later. It remains on us. So actually what we have is we have the wrath of God and our own guilt on us. remaining constantly on us. We need someone who can lift it off of us and take it off of us and do away with it in a just way. That's what we're actually after here. Hebrews 9:27 says, "It is appointed for a man to die once, and after that comes judgment." A day has been appointed for every one of us. Everyone in this room, and everyone you know, and everyone you don't know. A day has been appointed. I remember getting a piece of gospel literature one time in an order I made, and the title of it was, and it had a little picture of a clock on it ticking, and it said, "An appointment you will keep." And I thought that was a pretty clever way of looking at it. There is an appointment that all of us in this room are going to keep, whether we like it or not, whether we think we can escape it or not, and it's the appointment with God. It is appointed for all of us to die once. And after that comes judgment. And so mankind needs a mediator because of his verdict, the verdict he's under. Because he's been separated from God. Because he's a lawbreaker. That is why when we read this verse in 1 Timothy 2:5, it should take on a whole nother level of meaning to us. And it's, of course, not just for us. It's for us, first of all, because we don't deal with our own selves, right? Then how can we help other people? If I'm out drowning in the water, how am I going to save somebody else who's drowning if I'm drowning? I've got to first say, what about me? Am I right with God? And after I understand that, then I can reach out to other people. And so we need a lawyer who's qualified and successful to take care and to take our case before the judge. We need someone who is has both the status, they've passed their exams, they're qualified, and they have the skills to adjudicate our case. And you know, how about sometimes we see it in the movie, and I think it happens in real life sometimes, people who represent themselves in court, right? Somebody says, well, I'll represent myself, I can't afford a lawyer, or I don't want a lawyer, I'm going to try it on my own. There's a provision for that in our law, and I suppose every so often somebody tries that. But it doesn't work for us in this case. Why? We're guilty. We're already guilty. How can a guilty person get himself out of his guilt? I mean, that's the reason he's there. He's there because he already is guilty. And so, how are we going to get ourselves out of something that we're already guilty of? So that won't work. Maybe we could try another person. Maybe I could ride the coattails of my mother or father. They were religious. And basically, I'm just kind of hoping that because my mom and dad have been religious, and I was kind of religious along with them, that'll help me ride on in. Maybe my grandmother or an aunt or an uncle, very spiritual, pray for me, and maybe their prayers will just elevate me and lift me right in. Maybe if I'm good enough, it'll work. If I'm just good enough, I will get in. I'll just try to make up for it somehow. It's kind of like the man who comes into court and he says, well, Your Honor, I have done this bad thing that I'm here in court for, but my goodness, I'm actually a pretty good person otherwise. I mean, I took care of my grandmother, I paid my taxes, I've been honest in my work, I've helped people along the way. And the judge is going to look and say, oh, that's all very nice. Whether it's true or not, that's very nice, but you're not here for that. You're not here for that. You're not here because you were nice. You're not here because you did your grandmother well or you paid your taxes. You're here for your crime. I don't care about anything else you may have done in your past. You're here for one reason, to answer for the charges. We can't stand before God and say, Lord, I mean, I hope my goods outweigh my bad. And if my goods outweigh my bad on the scale, then you'll consider, he's going to say, no, you're not here for anything good you've done. You're here because of your crimes. You've broken my law. In fact, you've broken it all your life. You're here to answer for what you've done. So that doesn't work either. No other person, not even ourselves, is qualified. There's only one person qualified, and you see it in the verse, don't you? There's only one person qualified. There is one God, and there is one mediator between God and you, the man Christ Jesus. Jesus is the only mediator qualified Just as the ark was the only vehicle that saved Noah and his family out of the global flood, so Jesus is the only mediator that's going to save you out of your sin. Right? The Bible tells us very clearly. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We remember Acts 4:12, right? There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. It is Jesus Christ. He's the only one who's qualified. Well, let me just take a few minutes to look at why he's qualified. Jesus alone is qualified because he is God the Son. There are passages throughout the scripture, and we don't have time to go into all of them, but we can take just a few. For example, of course, at Christmas, we read through the passages in Luke and in Matthew, and it talks about Jesus, and his name is Emmanuel, which means God with us. Jesus is God with us, meaning he was born taking on humanity, became a person, became a man. And so this qualifies him because he is God with us. Again, so many passages. I'll just take one other one. We have dozens in Scripture. Take, for example, Romans 9:5, which says, to them belong the patriarchs, and from their race, according to the flesh, is the Christ, who is God over all, blessed forever. Amen. The Christ, comma, who is God over all, blessed forever. Christ is God. And so Christ in his divinity gave him authority, gave him power. We see in the Bible he has the power to forgive sins. This catches the attention of the religious leaders that were opposed to him, competing with him. They're like, you said you could forgive sins. Only God can do that. And Jesus is like, you know, on the phone, ding. That's right. Thumbs up. That's me. That's right. I can forgive sins because I am divine. And they were like, let's kill him. Because they realized he was claiming to be God. And they understood there was only one God, but they didn't understand who Jesus was. They didn't understand that God was triune. And so Christ is divine. He received worship, right? And of course, the Bible says that only God can receive worship. In fact, your Ten Commandments. And so if Jesus is receiving worship, either he is a false person or he's God. There's your two choices. And so when Jesus receives worship, he's receiving it because he is God the Son. And of course, he even says that he is the I Am, right? And the Jews knew that very well. That was the special name, Yahweh. It was a special name given to God that God revealed in the Old Testament. And they knew that when you say Yahweh, when you say the I Am, you are referring to the one and only God. And Jesus says to the Pharisees, I am the I Am. And again, they want to kill him for it. It's because he was saying, I am God, the Son. So he's qualified because he's God. That means he can handle our sins. That means he can overcome our guilt and sins. He has the power to do it and the innocence to do it. But secondly, it's because he's a man. He was a man as well. He took on humanity. All right? John says, you know, John was one of the 12, right? So if you look at like 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, you can listen to the language of this. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. And the life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testify to it and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We've seen him, we've touched him, we've heard him, we've handled him, we lived with him. Jesus was fully man and fully God. That made him qualified, unlike anyone else. Therefore, he is successful in whatever he mediates about. And this is why he could go to the cross and take our place and take our crimes on himself. He went to that cross. You look at a passage like 1 Peter 3:18. I think 1 Peter 3:18 does such a wonderful job of just encapsulating the gospel. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous, that's him, for the unrighteous, that's us. And he goes on, why do this? That he might bring us to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. So Christ suffered on the cross, he the righteous, for us the unrighteous, so that he can bring us to God, mediating the go-between. And so when that man was there in the courtroom and he realized, oh my goodness, I have a lawyer who actually is not qualified and he's doing a terrible job, I'm not going to be rightly represented, this is going to fail. Well, in our lives, for eternity's sake, we have a Jesus who is the only choice we have to mediate before us and the Father. And because he's God, and because he's man, he can actually take your case and he can reconcile you to God, because he himself takes your guilt on himself on the cross and pays for it. And he turns to you and says, I have done something for you. You need to repent and turn to me and place your faith and trust in what I have done for you. And when you do that, I mediate now between you and the Father. I've taken away your guilt, and now you're acceptable to God. That is the good news, isn't it? So when you look at this verse, say, thank you, Lord, that you sent a mediator, someone who will represent me and do it successfully. It's Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father God, we are so grateful. We exalt Christ this morning. We lift Jesus up on high, to the highest place we can. Father, he's there at the right hand of you on the throne. One day he will return. But for now, he is interceding for us, and he is our mediator, and he's the only one we have, and he is successful. Oh, Father, may we turn away from our own attempt to represent ourselves. May we turn away from having anyone else represent us. May we realize that in ourselves we are hopeless. We need Christ and his finished work on the cross applied to our account. Our charges can only be dropped by Jesus. Father God, I pray that you would draw people who don't know Jesus to him. And may we embrace him and him alone. And Father, I pray that for everyone here who is a believer already, that they are just reminded, that their heart will swell up with reminders of how precious and how necessary it is to know Jesus and to have Jesus, and what great grace has been given to us that we are in Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Motivate us by this week. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. And amen. Let's stand to our feet. And I want to give a very particular benediction, a word to go out on. It's one of my favorites. Listen to this. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you all. It's good to worship with you. We are dismissed.